In this graph, we're going to look at GI smooth muscle activity. Effectively, we're looking at the stimulus and response that generates the peristaltic contractions, the waves of contraction that travel along the GI tract once we eat a meal. Now, in this graph, we're going to have the membrane potential of our smooth muscle cells on the top graph in the red line here. Those would be the cells in the circular and longitudinal layers of smooth muscle in the wall of the GI tract. And then below that, we're going to actually graph the tension of those smooth muscle cells as it's being stimulated. Now, within that smooth muscle, within those layers of smooth muscle, we have what are known as interstitial cells of Cajal. And these are pacemaker cells that generate an intrinsic electrical rhythm, a rate at which they spontaneously depolarize and drive the contraction of the smooth muscle cells. And they do this by being electrically connected to them via gap junctions. Now, hopefully this sounds familiar because it's a very similar model to what we saw in the heart, where we had specialized pacemaker cells at the SA node, and those were linked electrically through gap junctions to the muscle cells of the heart, the cardiac muscle cells. Well, here we've got a similar system, these interstitial cells of Cajal, electrically coupled to the smooth muscle cells and initiating their contractions at a particular rhythm and in a particular strength. And those interstitial cells generate what's called a basal electrical rhythm. They're firing at a particular rate over time. And this varies by region. In other words, as we move through the GI tract, the rate of this basal electrical rhythm, it's also known as the slow wave, can differ. And it can vary from about 3 or 4 per minute to about 12 per minute, depending upon the region we're in. Now, what we'll note here, though, is that these interstitial cells of Cajal are intrinsically active. They're active essentially all the time. But you'll note that they generate this electrical depolarization, but they don't always reach the threshold of our smooth muscle cells to which we're electrically coupled. And therefore, the smooth muscle cells remain inactive. And you can see that if we come down below here, we don't have any contractions occurring, even though our interstitial cells are active here. Well, this would be between meals, right? We don't need peristalsis when there's no food present in the digestive tract. Once we eat a meal, we're going to still have our basal electrical rhythm, but now we're going to have additional stimulatory input to those cells, and their output is going to increase. They're going to reach the threshold of those smooth muscle cells to which they're electrically coupled, and we're going to get these individual action potentials that you see here, right? And that additional input can be neural from the enteric nervous system. It could be endocrine, distension itself, a stretch of the wall of the GI tract due to the presence of food. Those interstitial cells are actually sensitive to distension. And so we're going to get this greater stimulus going to those smooth muscle cells, causing them to reach threshold, generate action potentials, and now we can see that we're going to get tension development. Again, at the pace that's being determined by that basal electrical rhythm of the interstitial cells of Cajal. Now, the greater the frequency trains, the longer the string of action potentials in each of these cycles, the stronger the contraction will be. And so, therefore, the more neural and endocrine and distension input we have, the stronger the contractions we might get, and the more forcefully we would propel the food along the tract in these peristaltic waves.